Welcome to the Cult of Domesticity podcast. I'm Courtney.
And I'm Ashley.
Do you forget who you were?
No. What are you talking about?
I don't know. Every time it just sounds like you're questioning, like, I'm Ashley? Like Ron Burgundy? I'm Ron Burgundy?
I don't need your judgments on my name, woman.
I don't judge your name. So, Ashley, anything good happened to you this week?
Is it bad if I say no? It's just been a busy couple weeks, that's all.
Making all that dough.
But not a bad thing. How about you?
Yeah, it actually turned out okay. I know I was texting you while it was happening, but we got my grandpa to go to the doctor, which was a feat in itself.
Big win. Good.
He's 91. We used to tell him that he was the same age as the Queen and Hugh Hefner, but now he's just down to the same age as the Queen.
Oh, that's dark.
That's not that dark. I mean, Hugh Hefner died this year, so it's fine. He got his vanilla milkshake, aka his white milkshake, aka now his Anglo-Saxon milkshake. And if, for people who are going to be like, that's not politically correct, he's 91 with dementia. Like, let him have what he wants.
I'm going to call a vanilla milkshake from now on an Anglo-Saxon milkshake, and no one can stop me. So...
Oh, it was...
Come at me. Well, it's going to be great.
It's funny because he used to tell my sister he was like two-syllable John all the time.
What?
Yeah. My grandfather's in here. He doesn't use any word longer than two syllables.
Oh, okay. I was like, what happened just now?
Yeah. And then I told my sister and Caitlin, and she goes... Wait, he used the word Anglo-Saxon? And I was like, yeah.
Maybe he thought it was two words, and that's two syllables each, so it's fine.
So today is my turn. So for those of you who saw our tip-off and were wondering who that possibly could be and enjoyed my really lovely picture of a boat, we're going to talk about Christopher Columbus, the horrible person.
We have to.
Well, I did all the research, so yes.
Oh, fine.
Okay, so let's talk about this motherfucker. So, what was the world like in the 1450s? Glad you asked. I know you didn't ask, but since Columbus is Italian, in case you didn't know that.
Show of hands, who knew that? My hand is up. Okay. But only because of the Borgias did I know that. He's Italian.
The Islamic Empire is actually creeping over to Italy, taking land, taking some more land, killing a bunch of people, sailing some boats.
As empires do.
But this threat by the Ottoman Turks basically looms over Italy because they end up getting really close. And Christopher Columbus is born in Genoa, which is a big port city, big port empire, because Italy is not a thing, which is a whole other crying about over history that no one needs to deal with right now. So in 1451, we were graced with the presence of Christopher Columbus and his mother, Susanna, Fontanarossa, had married the master weaver Domenico Colombo, and those are his parents. They both come from weaving families in Genoa. When Columbus was two, the city of Constantinople, which for those of you who like Roman history will know was the eastern capital of the Roman Empire, fell to the Ottoman Turks. It pretty much devastated in the Western European mind this bastion of Christianity, so Orthodox Christianity. But Christopher was not an only child, shockingly, if you ever see birth rates of the period, popping them out like a t-shirt cannon.
Like, what?
T-shirt cannon?
That's awful. And I love it. Okay, continue.
You forget I've seen, like, the birth records of the period, and it's literally, like, every 2 years, got another kid.
That's so graphic, though. Just the image is burned through my brain now. Oh my goodness. Okay, that hurt. All right, continue.
Okay, so a year and some change after Christopher got a brother, Bartholomew, who was actually a successful human being, so good for him, and a sister, Bianchetta, which sounds like bruschetta. They had another brother who died, and the youngest of all, Jacobo, who was born 17 years after Columbus, Christopher. I'm just going to call him Seabus, and it's going to show that I'm from Ohio really hardcore, but I'm going to
say no one outside of Ohio is going to understand that, but I like it.
Brief aside, the capital of Ohio is Columbus, and it gets abbreviated to Seabus all the time. Like Cleveland gets abbreviated to land, the land, which is dumb. And
or as my father likes to call it, the mistake by the lake. Because you know, he gets great joy out of telling you that you live in the mistake by the lake.
Hey, we have good beer. There's actually...
It's fine.
It's cool. And Cincinnati is Cincy. So I'm going to refer to Columbus as Seabus just for pure brevity. And let my inner Ohioan come out. Okay. So Seabus's father is in the historic records, but... He seems like one of those businessmen that's really likable, but really shitty at business. You know, think Michael Scott from The Office. You like him, but you know he's really bad at his job. So this is the world that the young Seabus... Okay, that sounds dumb now that I'm hearing it repeatedly. Columbus became a sailor. There's no real clear record because he contradicts himself. And, you know, no one had social media at that time. So, according to his son Ferdinand, who wrote his biography, he said he had first become a seaman when he was 14. But this doesn't mean really, like, do you mean in a actual sense, a professional sense, were you just, like, out to sea? And remember, Genoa's on the Mediterranean, so he could be, like, sailing around since he was a child. And does that mean he's a sailor? Deep life questions. However, when he was 50, he wrote in a letter to Ferdinand and Isabella that he had first gone to sea at the age of 10. I don't know what to believe. We're going to go with around 1465, kind of in the middle of those two. He became a sailor, going with his son's sense of the ways. This means he's started at a young age. He's can be quite experienced by 1492, the date that all school children know. Columbus said he was an active participant in the rebellion against Juan II of Aragon. Don't want to go into it. Basically, Juan II was trying to take over parts of Italy because of inheritance, yada, yada, yada. Italy isn't a country. It's a bunch of kingdoms and city-states. So it makes it really annoying and confusing. And the fun thing is, Columbus actually wrote of it, and of this he wrote, "It happens that King René, now with God, sent me to Tunis to seize the galleys of Ferdinania. Now, when I was off the island of San Pietro near Sardinia, I was informed that the galleys was accompanied by two other ships and a carack. My crew were disturbed by the news and refused to carry on unless I returned to Marseille and pick up another ship and some more men. Seeing that I cannot force their hand without some ruse or artifice, I agreed to what they asked me. But then, having changed the pull of the magnetic needle, I made sail at nightfall, and the next morning at dawn we were off Cape Carthage, whereas all the board had been quite certain we were making for Marseilles." So he seems to be an accomplished sailor, and even a captain at this point. And this rebellion occurred between 1470 and 1473. So you're looking at about 5 to 8 years after we can, like, be certain he's been sailing it for a given amount of time. The fun thing about doing this research is there isn't a lot of historical record for his early life before he becomes an adult, which isn't unusual for someone who was born a weaver's son, or master weaver, I should say. He's earned it. So we learn a lot through his life looking back, or telling what he told his sons. So who knows? This could be all bullshit. And we can have a discussion about that at the end, if it's bullshit or not. Because I tend to believe at this point that they tend to be bullshitty. As well as, so during this time, he's also voyaging to the island of Chios. This is in the Aegean Sea. But why mention it, you ask? Because these repeated voyages to Chios help Columbus later in life when you're sailing around the Caribbean to determine islands, to sailing around when you can't see any land. Because as the author of the book I read, which was Ernol Bradford's Christopher Columbus, pretty good read, said, he saw new waters, new aspects of sky and land, and beheld for the first time unknown islands rising from the sea at dawn. He learned about the violent squalls that can descend on a vessel when she is on the lee side of high land, and how the wind-impelled currents can drive at one or two knots through narrow channels separating one Aegean island from another. So basically, it's good practice for figuring how to find land, how to sail difficult seas. So after he is in this rebellion against Juan II and sailing to the island of Chios, we know he pops up in 1476 on a Flemish merchant ship. Ashley, do you know what Flanders is besides the character from The Simpsons?
I know that Flemish is like the national language of Belgium. So yes. I want to say Flanders is probably a city in Belgium, but I could be wrong.
It used to be it's a region that used to be a country, but Flemish is that northern Danish Belgian region scattered throughout there. I can't remember exactly where it is, but it's in northern Europe. But it was a prominent trading city. You see art in the Flemish style. So think of Netherlands, Belgium, that kind of style, that area. Very prominent in early banking, early sailing, and all of that jazz. So Columbus is on a Flemish merchant ship. I should also mention that at this period of time, you don't have to sail under your own country's colors. And that includes in the military, so you can serve under any military that you wish, as long as they pay you. Hopefully they pay you. And we see this pretty much until the 19th, 20th century that people are working under different colors, shall we say. It was more popular or common for sailors just because it's such a hard skill set and you need the experience to learn it, that you'll see in a lot of accounts that ships especially will be a hodgepodge of different nationalities, basically because if you know that, say, the British pay well, they'll pay on time, why not serve under the British Navy during a time of war? Because you get a chance at getting some extra cash with the booty.
The booty!
So, Columbus is on this Flemish merchant ship sailing in a convoy of Genoese, gosh, I should have learned Italian, ships destined for Portugal, England, and Flanders. So Flemish Flanders. However, this Flemish convoy encounters French naval forces and there's an ensuing battle. They're all like, pew, pew, psh, psh, fire. Ships getting blown up and all of that. And Columbus ends up with a group of sailors from his ship and several other ships wrecked off of the Gauss. And from here, we see him going to Lisbon, Portugal. From here, he hooks up on the first ship that is available for work and sails to Iceland, where he hears stories of land to the west. There's this mysterious land to the west that people know of. Does that remind you of anything?
It reminds me of Vikings and Ragnar Lothbrok, but...
What stories about the land to the west could Columbus have heard? There is the beautiful saga. I just read that as Sega. Like a video game. Saga of Eric the Red. So your answer of Vikings was correct.
Woo!
Woo! Applause, fireworks.
Victory day.
So, this saga, not Sega, described many things, but specifically about Eric's two sons, Left, who sailed directly from Norway for Greenland in the year 1000.
Did he just, like, go left? Is that why they called him left? Or what's the deal there? You know?
I think it's just a Norwegian or Scandinavian name.
It's kind of boring. Sorry, Norway. I was hoping for a better story than that.
So, left. Left. I'm sure it's probably, like, left. If you're from Scandinavia, please let us know. He missed Cape Farewell, the southernmost point of Greenland. That is a very apt cape name. Cape Farewell. Farewell.
Are you going to call it Cape Hello? No. Not what Cape, it's called the last time you're going to see them.
I think it should be Cape Bye Bitch. And left landed in either Nova Scotia or Newfoundland. I'm going to read you some of the saga. So, Left and his men, and here's where it starts, were a long time at sea, finally striking upon land they had not expected. It had fields of natural, and then brackets, self-sown wheat and wine berries. Among the trees were maples, end quote. The new land they called Vineland, or Wineland, after the grapes.
I was going to say, isn't a wine berry just a grape?
Yes. Then when he returns to Portugal, there are 8 years unaccounted for, really. So we know this period is 1477 to 85. And we know at this time he's either in Portugal or a Portuguese sailor. He's doing one of the two. Try keeping paper aboard a wooden ship. It's very difficult. It's not a good time. But there was little documentation. One merchant he ran into said Columbus had very little formal education. But he was a man of keen intelligence, very skilled in cosmography and in making maps of the world. And this is also where we find out that in these 8 years, he learned the rudiments of Latin and became a fluent Portuguese speaker. And he probably learned Castilian Spanish later in life, most likely when he got to Spain. Or Castilian was also spoken by the upper classes in Portugal, but he could definitely work as a map maker or bookseller when he wasn't at sea. And those, for people who don't know what cosmography is, Ashley, do you know what it is?
Isn't it charting the stars?
No, it's how to describe. It's a weird hodgepodge of like map making, historical record. Think of it like a really funky atlas, but with legends and histories and botany and all of that thrown in with some astrology as well. So this is where we get early maps. Most people were cosmographers as well as making maps. So especially if you're doing global maps, they're really cool to look at. And I highly suggest it. Not just because I took a class on it, but that's besides the point. And you're here though there. So what else was Columbus doing in these 8 mysterious years? He got married.
Aww.
To Felipa Moniz Perestro. Perestro. Sorry, I'm pronouncing this with in Spanish. I don't speak Portuguese. She was the daughter of Bartholomew Perestro, who had been made the first governor of Porto Santo and the Madeiras, so the islands off of Africa. She was also the granddaughter of Gil Moniz, who was from one of the oldest families in Portugal and who had been a close companion of the great Prince Henry. So she is some pretty old school aristocratic fancy ass shit. Like, that's her lineage. So why is it significant to mention Prince Henry, who is like best friends with her grandfather? Well,
because he probably leveraged that royal connection to get financing for whatever crazy trip he wanted to go on of his own accord.
Well, a little bit, but I mean, being married to a really, really aristocratic person does help open a lot of doors. I know.
You know, single experience, right?
Oh, of course. Not desperately single here. It's fine.
Nope, not here either. It's fine.
It's fine. Actually, Prince Henry was one of Portugal's princes in the early 15th century who laid the foundations for Portugal's overseas empire and initiated the great age of exploration. So he's really the one who for Europe kicked everything off. He was sending ships out, like, trying to find faster routes to China, India, around the Mediterranean, mapping the African coast. So we, Europeans have a lot to be thankful for that. The rest of the world, not so much. Ashley, do you want to hear how they met and fell in love? Because I think you're really going to enjoy this.
Oh, absolutely. Hit me with it. I love a good romance.
They met, according to his son, at the Covenant of the Saints in Lisbon, where Columbus used to go to attend Mass.
Okay, that is actually really cute, because my mom and my stepdad met at church, and that's some adorable stuff right there.
Oh, it gets less adorable?
Of course it does. It's Christopher Columbus.
So, why is it significant that he went to this specific church? Because for ambitious young men who wanted to be acquainted with a potential wife from the upper classes, there was no better place to go than this church. Young women were scrupulously chaperoned, and there was no social life where you could meet a bride of that stature outside of church. And so churches were used specifically for two sexes to interact with each other and see each other. And even in later on in more relaxed societies than Portugal, they were used for these interactions. So basically you'd go to Mass to find your true love.
I mean, I still think that's kind of sweet though. I mean, I would hope that you would go to church for other reasons too, but if that's, even if that's the only one, like, you're still there, right?
Yeah. It's kind of sweet, but also kind of sad that he's purposely picking a certain church to go to, because it's known for having...
Can't even go to church without having, like, ulterior motives that they have to deal with. But at the same time, who says that they're not going there just to piss off their parents and marry someone lower down the social ladder?
I like it. Go to church to piss off your parents.
Typical 15th century rebellious teenager, always in church.
So, why would this aristocratic girl marry this really unknown Genoese sailor mapmaker? Well, they were not very well off financially. The mom had another daughter that she needed to raise and support, and had to maintain her own status. And her husband, Bartholomew Perestro, had died in Port Santo. And they were so financially stricken that she had to sell off the rights in the governorship of the island. So they broke!
That would do it.
So Columbus and his new bride, and then they have a kid named Diego, lived with her mother for a while, you know, living that great life. But between 1480 and 83, they moved to Porto Santo in Funchal, which is in the main island of Madeira. So it's the capital city. So this time Columbus is, you know, living his life, trying to support his family with being a sailor merchant, learning everything he can, map making, all of that, building connections. Interestingly, these islands off of the coast of Africa keep having more evidence that there's some unknown land in the Western Atlantic. So for people who say, oh, they didn't know, they had hints. There were hints. They were like these weird sticks would come up and they're like, oh, that's strange. Some bodies sometimes would make it all the way across the Atlantic. So, and they were like, well, these aren't Africans, and these aren't people who live in Madeiras or the Azores. So there must be, like, something else. And current theory states that it was probably Carib natives who were on their canoes and they went really far out or got caught up by the current and ended up dying and ended up off the coast of Africa. Because that's how currents work! Are you laughing at my song?
Yeah.
So Columbus is sailing often, going between the islands and the west coast of Africa, because there is a strong Portuguese trade and they're building trading posts all along the Gold Coast. Because, you know, gotta get all those slaves and shit from Africa. They return. The Columbus family returns to Lisbon in 1484. Sebas meets with the King John II of Portugal about his plans because he thinks he can get to China or India real quick. He does. He thinks the earth is very small. Smaller than people think. Yeah, just a little bit. So, King John II, I was really happy they made this in the English version because it's like, wow, ciao. I cannot pronounce Portuguese. He was known to the Portuguese people as John the Perfect. It's a great thing to be known as.
No pressure,
yeah. He was very ambitious for his country's overseas tenure, and he was determined to stabilize Portugal by curbing the power of nobles at home, aka authoritarian.
Yeah, definitely perfect.
Sorry. No big deal. So John was intrigued by Columbus, but he's like, I'm going to need to check this out. So he commissions a report. Well, he appointed a commission who created a report, and they were like, yeah, probably not. There's probably no way to do this. But John was really, really intrigued. So he sent out his own voyage. So he funded a couple ships to go and be like, let's see, follow this guy's instructions. And it failed. So the next year, because of this failed attempt, John II of Portugal rejected Columbus's voyage. Also, his wife, Dona Filipa, died. So it's a bit of a rough year.
Poor girl. Poor guy. I actually kind of feel bad for him on that one. That sucks.
I know. So he's dejected. Columbus takes his 5-year-old son, Diego. And I'm not going to lie, did I think of Go Diego Go? Yes.
Because I did too.
They went to the small port of Palos in Andalusia. And this makes me very happy because I love Andalusia. I only lived there for 6 weeks, but I love it. Okay. Was he just leaving Portugal because he was really, really sad? What do you think, Ashley?
Yes, but also no.
He was very in debt and being pursued by his creditors. So, he's in this small town of Palos, and he arranges with the monastery that takes in travelers and all this, and he places his son Diego in the monastery where he would begin his education. And Columbus fortuitously got on really well with the friar, who was also really, really interested in cosmography and if there's land out to the west. And the friar introduces Columbus to the Count of Medina City. And this is how Columbus gets an interview with the Reyes Católicos, aka Ferdinand and Isabel, who I'm going to refer to them as the Reyes Católicos for the rest of the time because it's shorter. While we don't know if he actually met with them that year because they're fighting a war constantly against the Moors, the one account from La Casa said that Columbus asked for no more than 3 or 4 cavels to attempt the passage, but we do know that his reception at court was not unfavorable. But again, they're fighting a war. So from 1485 to 1490, Columbus is chilling in Spain, hanging out. And we know for a period of time that probably most of the time, he's following the court around, and he is very poor. Like, very, very poor. The comment of the state of his cloak was often brought up in that it was shit. Threadbare and looking sad.
Court around then, if he can't afford a new cloak.
He's one of those hanger-on, so he can get fed and he can do work and stuff. He does work with making maps and all that, but he's making subsistence, if that. So he can't afford to buy a new cloak or anything like that. So we do know in 1486 there is the first documented meeting with the Reyes Católicos, both of them, in Cordova, and they are convinced enough to convene a special commission to judge his theories and claims. So the same thing that Juan II did. In the next year, Columbus begins receiving a pittance, and he's hoping for a positive outcome from this commission. This reason was he knew he had at least one member on the commission, Diego de Deza, a Dominican friar, on his side, and possibly Hernando de Talavera, and they would fight for him within this commission to determine the outcome. His pittance was roughly the same as a working man's wage, but again, you're a kingdom at war, and so the state of the treasury can't be that healthy. And I love the description. Sufficient to keep body and soul together, but little more.
I mean, that's just straight up poetic.
Yeah. In 1488, so in this 5 years of wandering around poverty, Columbus meets Beatriz Enriquez and has a new son, Ferdinand. Beatriz is the daughter of more common folk who were also Genoese. So there might be because she's the daughter of lower people, that might be the reason why Columbus didn't marry her, because his last wife was upper nobility and that has more prominence than his mistress. But hey, you got another son out of it. Wait, so
they weren't married though?
No. They never got married.
Okay. I was thinking that they did.
Nope.
Okay, see, this is a little bit more progressive story than I thought it was. I thought they were married.
But her family's okay with it, for some reason.
Well, maybe they're more lax because they were aristocracy, maybe?
Or the fact that he said, I'm going to do all this great stuff. And and then you can... I mean, her family was on the trips across the sea.
Oh, really? Okay. So yeah. He followed through.
Yeah, they came with them.
Okay. All right, fair enough.
So, unfortunately, in the same year as his son being born, his pittance is cut off, so we really don't know where he is. Before, you could track him through his, like, small allowance. Now you're like, where in Spain is Christopher Columbus? And then in 1490, the commission report comes in, and it goes, yeah, this is not feasible. It's not a good idea. So the next year, in 91, Columbus returns to the monastery to collect Diego and plans to meet his brother in France. Why France, you ask? Because his brother, Bartholomew, you know, the one that I said is a successful human being, went to the French court where the elder sister of King Charles VIII, Anne de Beaujeu, became his patron, and he was working at Fontainebleau as a map maker. So he's a successful person, unlike his brother at this point. However, in 1492, several privy members and Columbus's friends convince Isabel to fund Columbus. And let's just go with the famous legend that Isabel sold her jewelry to fund this thing. She did not. That is a myth. Get over it. I've seen the box that they said her jewels were in here and she sold them all. But yes, she was an amazing woman and she did not sell her jewels. Let's put it that way. So she says, okay, we can do this because this is Louis de Saint-Angel, who is keeper of the privy purse, told her, he goes, it's a worthwhile risk because if the adventurer failed, no more than two or three small ships would be lost. If, on the other hand, he triumphed, honors, titles, and percentages would be little in compared to what would accrue to the throne and the Spanish treasury. So basically, like, well, if he fails, we lose, like, two to three ships of men and all that. That's fine. But if he succeeds and gets to Asia, yes! All the stuff. So Columbus and the crown signed their contract on April 17th, 1492. So basically, Columbus has been fighting for this for, like, 6 years. And finally, in 1492... it all happens within 1492. It's 1 year. So when they say 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue, they ain't wrong, but also 1492, Columbus did everything, like everything to get that journey going from January to October when he found the region.
So do you think on New Year's Eve, he the end of 1491 into 1492, you think he did that, like, white girl thing where he was like, this year I'm gonna accomplish all my dreams, and then, but like, unlike most of us, he actually did it.
Can someone please draw Christopher Columbus as a white girl just like wishing, like with a champagne and like a thing, being like
all of these things that he writes down just sound really crazy, but then he actually follows through and does them all,
like New Year, New Me,
right? Yeah, no, that's the title of the list.
Are you ready to hear his demands? Like, that this is in the contract.
Oh, demands, yes, let's hear his
five basic points. One, Columbus is to be made admiral of the ocean, ocean sea, and of the countries which he is to discover. He shall hold this dignity throughout his life, and it shall descend to his heirs. Two, he is to be the viceroy and governor general of all the continents and islands he shall discover. Three, he shall have a tenth share of all gold, silver, pearls, jewels, and other merchandise that shall be found, bought, gained, or otherwise produced in the countries which he is to discover. Four, he's as admiral or a deputy appointed by him, shall be the sole judge in any dispute regarding mercantile matters that shall occur in the countries which he is to discover. Five, he has the option of investing an eighth part in any ships which may sail to these new countries, and in return, he may take any eighth part of the profits.
So this is just all legitimately crazy is what you're getting at.
I mean,
that seems like a lot to me.
It's a lot.
That they're granted.
They also don't think he's coming back.
Well, but even so, like, on the off chance that he does come back, I don't know. It still seems like a lot, even if you're sending him on a dead man's errand. You know what I mean?
I think the fifth one, which is, like, he has an option to take, like, invest in any ship that is going to the new country. Like, even if they don't want him to, like, they could be fully funded, and he's like, nope, I'm investing in this. This is mine now.
I don't know. That's not, I mean, that's crazy. But, like, the one that really grabbed me was that he's viceroy and governor of anything he touches. Like,
yeah,
that's insane. This is a man that literally went around in tattered clothes, even when they were paying him and, like, sustaining him. And they're going to let him be in charge of whatever he discovers when he can't even be in charge of his own purse?
Yeah.
Really?
You know what? He put a flag on it, you know? If you like it, put a flag on it.
Yeah.
I enjoy that he gets a tenth share of any shit taken out of whatever he finds.
Yeah, that was also, like, this dude had everything to gain.
And these are the terms that he put before John II of Portugal, and they were like, no.
Can you imagine, like, having the testicular fortitude to throw that in front of not one, but two sets of reigning monarchs and just be like, here's what you're going to pay me for doing this thing that you two are entirely sure I can
would
do.
Say no, but then I think of our president and I'm like, oh, right.
That's not testicular fortitude. That's something.
Yes, but the man bankrupted two casinos, and I don't understand that. But back to another asshole. Christopher Columbus. First, he has to get his ships. You know, how are you going to sail across the ocean? The town of Palos had, for some unspecified time, committed an offense. And mind you, offense is in quotations, against the crown. And it had been, and this is also in quotes, condemned and ordered by the royal council to provide, should it be required, two cavels fully equipped and prepared for a whole year's service. So they just forced some town to be like, give us two tiny ships with men and stuff. You did something. But it saved them a ton of money. So they get their ships. Columbus gets another ship. And they depart Spain August 3rd. Let's get into the names of the ships, because I really enjoyed this because I didn't know this. So this is from the same biography. He went real deep into this. The names of the ships can hardly have appealed to Columbus's somewhat puritanical tastes, and it is only almost certain that it was at his instigation that his flagship had her name changed to Santa Maria, Holy Mary. Do you want to know what they were? She started out, Santa Maria started her life out as La Gallega, the woman of Galicia, yes. And at some time or another, had been renamed to Mar Galante, or Naughty Mary. And Columbus changed them because it was probably unsuitable to have a ship called the Naughty Mary as the flagship of the Admiral of the Ocean Sea. And the
most, know, man. I kind of like
I love
that.
This historian shade more metal. Right now. He goes,
I kind of dig it.
Equally, undoubtedly, her crew continued to call her Naughty Mary. So he's like, yeah, Columbus renamed her, but they were like, no.
Good. Good.
Really, we're being forced into this. Let's not.
They were like, but really, we know the truth.
Called the Painted One, a sailor's euphemism for a whore. Okay. So we have the Naughty Mary, the Painted One, aka the whore, and La Nina, the girl. Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's the trio you want, finding the new world.
Okay. However, you know, for as shambly as Columbus's life has been up to this point, it was actually, for 15th century standards, this was actually a well-planned and equipped...
voyage? Is that the one you're going for?
Sorry, forgot a word. Yes. Yeah. It was a well-planned and equipped voyage with good seaworthy ships manned by first-class sailors. So they head to the Canaries as a little like jumping off point rather than Spain. And they leave the Canaries on September 3rd. They had to do some repairs because La Pinta had some issues that needed to be fixed with her rudder and such. So once they get out of sight of land, Columbus begins practicing his most famous piece of deception, keeping a true log in, which was not actually that true, nautical-wise, for himself and a falsified one for the benefit of the crews. Yeah. He has two books.
The old double book trick. Another thing you have in common with the president.
Yeah. So, there was actually a gentleman who followed the same voyage as Columbus, like, recreated it, and he found that actually the sailor's log was truer than Columbus's own log. But the problem was there's no actual certain way at that point to tell how far they had gone, because they had, the Europeans had lost the Roman method of tracking distance when sailing, and I'm not going to go into how they actually, he actually accounted for distance, but he, let's just do an example of this. So Monday, September 10th, his own log made that they had run 60 leagues, whereas his crew log said 48 leagues, and a league is equivalent to about 3 nautical miles. So he's basically saying there's 12 leagues difference.
What's the difference between a nautical mile and a regular?
I don't know. No. Waves.
Okay, good then.
Waves are the difference.
Oh my god, really?
Okay, so there begin to be problems towards the end of September because they're not sighting land. They had problems with, they lost the wind, so they're just kind of in wooden boats, not really moving very fast. At this point, Columbus is pretty sure that people are trying to kill him. And I mean, I don't blame them. A lot of the sailors didn't want to go, so.
They
no.
Because I don't.
And he told this delegation that said, hey, we should turn around. And he goes, there is no point in your complaining. No point at all. I'm going to the Indies and I shall sail on until, with God's help, I find them. So they're like, he's basically telling them that, yeah, bitch, no, we're going. So basically, they submit for a little bit. And mind you, ships at this point in time are dangerous to be aboard. Like, you can die from just doing your job. You can fall from the rigging. Something can fall on you. You could go overboard. It's very tenuous. And captains, he says he's the admiral of the ocean seas, so he has ultimate command. He can have you flogged. He could have your punishment be horrible to a point that it might not be worth fighting him. It might, at this point, they all agree it's not worth taking him on.
Yeah. That makes sense. I get that.
So they have, in early September, they have a false sighting of landfall, which Columbus, it's my favorite one. It's the shadiest shit that he pulls.
Oh my god.
So on October 7th, there was another false illusion of landfall. The Nina thought she saw land. However, it was just clouds and...
What? How do you make that mistake? Really?
I've never sailed on the open ocean, so I don't know. But
leave it to the girl who has no idea what's going on to be like, look, it's land, but no, it's a cloud.
It's a cloud. So this is making the mood on the ships even better, especially because Columbus said, hey, You get 10,000 maravis to the first man who sights land, and Columbus would personally give him a silk doublet. So he's like, here's a bunch of money and a silk doublet. And
this seems like good leadership, though. Just incite a riot amongst your crew members.
Or make people who are really desperate to find fucking land even more desperate.
Well, yeah, but after months and months on a ship with Christopher Columbus, would you not already be really desperate to find land?
They're only about a month out. That's a crazy thing.
Okay, but still, that's a month.
With this man. You just hope you're not on the Naughty Mary. Maybe be on the girl. Or the painted one.
I mean, the painted one just had a repaired rudder. Wow. Repaired rudder. So, arguably, that's the better one to be on.
Okay, so, about 10 p.m., Columbus thought he saw a light, like a wax candle that rose and fell ahead of the ships. And this is how he claims the prize.
So wait, he claimed his own prize?
Yeah.
What a jerk. If I was a soldier or one of the sailors, I probably would have gone full Pirates of the Caribbean and stranded him on an island with his nothing but his chest hair and two sea turtles to escape with. But they probably had more restraint than I do, so.
Yeah, and the thing is, he asked two seamen if they can sell. So one said he could see something, the other said he saw nothing at all. So.
But I mean, how do you not then split it with the dude who was like, yeah, I totally see something there?
Because it's Columbus.
Valid. Okay, fair enough.
So, at 2 a.m., at 2 a.m., Friday, October 12th, because the Pinta, which was surging away from the little fleet, fired the gun signal, land in sight, most people were like, false alarm? But all of a sudden, there appears to be white cliffs ahead. So this is the island which is now known as San Salvador, or on British charts, Watling's Island.
San Salvador sounds way better. Rolls off the tongue easy.
Yeah. Christopher Columbus named it after Savior of Mankind.
I mean, I get that. Still not a he met his wife at church. What else did you expect?
Yeah. And so
and he's being financed by two super Catholic monarchs, so
the most Catholic of all monarchs.
True. Although Catherine of Aragon could probably give them a run for their money, but anyway.
I mean, they are related. Actually, that's her daughter.
Yeah, I know.
I had to think. How do you think she got that Catholic?
True. It's true.
So the natives are watching, like, who the fuck are they? What the fuck are those, like, to the ships? Because they've never seen ships with sails, and the natives were specifically a branch of the Arawak group. Natives of South America who had been immigrated from the mainland within the recent centuries and had been enslaved or exterminated an earlier wave of immigrants to the island. So they're like, these strange people are coming aboard our home, and they're very friendly to them, which might have been a mistake. The next day, October 13th, they went again and explored the island more thoroughly, which attracted the attentions of the Arawak people. And their leader, kind of their downfall was they had rings of gold hanging from their noses. And the Spanish were like, ah, the gold, that's what we came for. So just think of the song from Pocahontas, but they found gold. And the native people didn't realize they were fucked. My favorite thing was they brought an Arabic translator because they thought they were going to be in Asia. And, you know, there's Islam all over the world. So they're like, ah. Easy. Everyone speaks Arabic or someone will know Arabic. Well, no, that guy was useless. So they were communicating via simple hand gestures. And they figured out that the gold came from some land in the south. And the word for this land sounded like Cucubana. So this is the center of Cuba. But you want to guess what Columbus thought Cubanacana was?
I really have no
Kublai idea. Khan, a.k.a. relation of Genghis Khan, like the Mongols. I found it! Guys, we're good! We're good! I found Asia! I found Asia!
Who's the best? I'm the best. Who's the best?
Okay, so.
That's a direct quote.
I believe it. That sounds like Columbus. Well, now the Spaniards are like, let's go look for other areas of Asia. And they put some natives on their ship. And he's like, okay, show us on your boats, too.
Fine.
Yeah.
They didn't have anything to do that day.
No. And he's like, show us where these other lands are. Well, his...
And they were like, what?
Well, he learned very quickly that the European ships could not catch the canoe, the boats, the natives' boats.
Like when you're following someone in traffic and you get stuck in a red light, but they get to go ahead and you're like, I don't know where to go without you. I hope you wait for me.
No, it's like someone's in the fast lane on the freeway and you're stuck. You're like cornered by two semis.
Oh, the worst.
Yeah. Also, the fact that one of the natives jumped off the boat into a canoe that came alongside, and as well as...
Can you imagine them doing circles around the ship?
That'd be great.
Like, while it's trying to move forward.
They're also jumping, like, they would jump ship and just swim away. So they're just like... So I could just picture...
That's arguably the smartest in this entire story.
Yeah, I can picture Columbus is like... Yeah, the Columbus is like, yes, very, very good, very good. You stay on the ship and you show us where the other places are and we take care of you. And the native's like, strange...
But they're like...
Strange man. Who's the strange man? Yeah, I know that island. I'm out. Okay, later. You seem nice and all, but no, I didn't want to come. Okay, bye. And then he just runs away.
Like, I actually had a bunch of errands to do today, so I'm tapping out later. Have fun finding what you're not even
here. Yeah. Bradford, historian Bradford, says that, again with the sass, again. So Bradford said, this incident alone should have convinced him that the Indians did not think he was doing them a service by removing them from their native islands.
And yeah. Correct.
So... He is traveling around from October 12th until January 16th, 1493, around the Caribbean. And basically, he didn't know any of this was there. However, before he returned back to Spain, the Santa Maria, aka Naughty Mary, hit a coral reef. And they couldn't really save her, but they were able to get a bunch of the valuable shit off the boat, most of it, and get it to shore. So Columbus was like, you know what? I'm going to found a European settlement here. He named it La Navidad. So yeah, Christmas. And it's where it's in Haiti now. And he sailed from La Navidad January 4th in the Nina. He left behind 21 men under the command of Diego de Harana, the cousin of his mistress. See, I said they were fine with it. They chill with him.
Classy. I know.
So they made really good time until they reached the Azores, crossing the Atlantic, when they ran into a bad storm and it separated the Nina from two of the ships. Columbus gets anchored off the Portuguese island of Santa Maria, where they were imprisoned because the local governor thought they had sailed on an illicit voyage to West Africa because it was all under the Portuguese now. They get to leave February 24th and then hit by storms again. So Columbus manages to make it to Portugal, where he's summoned by King John II, who actually received the first report of the discovery of America, not the Reyes Católicos. In Portugal, they managed to repair the Nina, who by now, I don't know how any of these ships are afloat. They weren't actually that well, like they were kind of older ships and like not doing well. On March 14th, they leave Portugal and return to Spain the next day. And then on April 7th, the Reyes Católicos had received Columbus's report and asked him to meet them in Barcelona to start preparations for the next voyage. I've been at the palace where they did this. Okay. I know. So he arrives at court in Barcelona in April 20th. He's there for 3 months, but... And like the discovery is like spreading throughout Europe. They're like, oh my God, there's something there. There is a land to the west. Strange, weird, huh? Wonder what it is.
Who would have thought?
Again, one of my favorite things. Native Americans who came back with Columbus began to spread syphilis in Europe, much as the Europeans spread smallpox and measles to the Americas.
Very true. That's right.
Well, especially because, you know, smallpox and measles, They suck, but you could, like, die or, like, recover from them. Syphilis makes you go mad. I think that's a fair trade.
Well, and if you think about how you contract syphilis...
Yeah.
Think of how many of those encounters were consensual.
Six.
Probably not a lot. I mean, I feel like syphilis is sort of I mean, they kind of deserved it, if we're assuming that most of those were not consensual encounters. So, I don't know. I feel like that's fair.
Yeah.
No?
I don't know.
Either way.
I think it's fair.
Not a great situation.
Okay. So, second voyage, much larger. They got 17 ships. And the flagship, again, is the Santa Maria, but not the Naughty Mary. It's a different ship. They brought about 1,200 to 1,500 men. No women. So the whole syphilis conversation. Let's repeat on that. So the second voyage starts September 25th, 1493. So he's only been back in Europe for a couple months. They stop in the Canary Islands and then head out. They reach Dominica, which is named so because they reached it on Sunday. You know?
Super creative, and I dig it.
Mm-hmm. This is where they encounter the first Caribs. They're a different native people from the Arawaks, and they had a reputation for warlike fierceness. Basically, they're going around. They get attacked by some of these groups. They reach Puerto Rico on the 19th. So, hey, Puerto Rico. If you're interested in that, go check out one our other episodes. Hangs out there for a little bit. And then they reach their goal of their settlement of La Navidad on November 27th. Ashley, what do you think they found? Ruins and unburied bodies of the Spanish everywhere.
Oh, I don't want to laugh at that, but it's already happening.
And no one knows what happened, so...
You can guess, though, no?
Well, it doesn't say... It just says unburied bodies, so they don't, like...
illness?
Yeah, or... So, the theories are the Spanish had made too many demands on the Arawaks, turning them against them, or the Spanish fought among themselves, or it was a combination... Or they all got syphilis and died. That's not how that works. Sorry, that's not how that works.
That's not how any.
So they abandoned the site, and Columbus took his new colonists, mind you, all dudes, 75 miles east to the small shell bay where he built a trading fort called Isabella in the now Dominican Republic. So then Columbus sends Alonso de Oleja to the interior mountains where he did find gold. So. Yay, gold. Well, they send a bunch of gold, some stuff he thought were spices, with a lot of the ships back to Spain with like, hey, look at all this shit we found. 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 It's the end of that song. So he only has 5 of the 17 ships left. And Columbus is like, let's go explore this island. Let's do this. So the beginning of April, he does that. And then... On June 12th, a curious incident occurred. What do you think it was?
I'm not sure, but can we talk about how 5 out of 17 ships is like 29% and not even close to a passing grade?
Did you just do the math?
Yeah, I did. That's why it took me so long. Sorry.
Yeah, that was kind of dumb. Maybe they had a lot of shit to send back. Be like, here's one ship of gold, I think is this spice, one ship of people who are like, please send me back.
That would be more than one ship. That was like 4 ships.
Well, not now. Now they're like, there's something there. Let's go. Okay. So what do you think this curious incident was?
Probably something to do with the indigenous people.
Actually, no. Columbus gathered all of the men together and made them swear an oath that the land they had been traveling along was not an island, but the main part of Asia.
What?
Yeah.
What?
Yep.
Why?
So
why would he do that?
He was trying to convince himself that he was in the Indies. Which means, like, India, Asia, like, China, like, all that. He thought,
self-delusion.
He is. So, he was ill and was forced to return to Isabella at the end of September 1494. Once there, he discovered his brother had arrived from Spain. So, yay, Bartholomew, the successful one.
Yay.
Yep. About the same time, the Arawak natives of Hispaniola realized that the Spanish meant their destruction and collected a large force to try to drive them off. But that failed at the end of March. And after the Arawak people were enslaved and died of European diseases. So that solved that problem a little bit.
That's one way for to look at it.
What?
I said that's one way to look at it.
It was easier for the Europeans. So, while they're fighting off the Arawak people and enslaving them and letting them slowly die of smallpox and such, the colonists at Isabella were not doing too well, and Columbus decided to return to Spain on March 10th to explain the situation to Ferdinand and Isabella. Bartholomew is left in charge and quickly moves the site to the south side of the island at Santo Domingo, which, if you know, Dominican geography is the capital, right? I feel like I would know. I should know this. Gilberto's going to be pissed. So Columbus returns to Spain on the Nina, the girl, again, with one other tiny ship. So let's remind you, how many ships are here? Well, I'm guessing other ships arrived, so never mind. So Nina and another tiny ship go back to Spain. And this is where it gets weird. Like, weirder. He lands in Cadiz, and historians have not been able to explain his next actions. He adopted the coarse dress of a Franciscan friar and stayed at austere monasteries. He lived like this for 2 years.
We call that the Rodrigo. I'm glad you got that. That was good. That was a deep cut reference.
And
again, the Borgias. You're welcome.
Yeah. So while doing that, while living like a Franciscan friar, he is trying to convince the Reyes Catholicos to send him out on a third mission of discovery. And he keeps visiting him. They finally agree to put him in charge of a small fleet to Hispaniola in 1497. Doesn't leave until end of May 1498 because Columbus had trouble finding ships and supplies. He goes south and lands on the island of Trinidad at the beginning of August. They discover Venezuela. What is Venezuela? And they're having trouble, they're having trouble with the currents along the coast of South America. So some of his ships are threatening to sink. So they set foot in Venezuela, and Columbus calls it Terrias del Paradis. So paradise, earthly paradise, you know. He arrives in Santo Domingo, August 21st, and he is greeted by his brother, Bartholomew, and they are hanging out on the island administering the gold mines, but the Reyes Catholicos are hearing the unfavorable reports about the brothers' ruling and administrative tactics, and so they send, July 1500, they send Francisco de Borobdilla to replace Columbus and become the new governor. So he gets to Santo Domingo and finds the Spanish inhabitants in a state of rebellion and immediately arrests Christopher, Diego, and Bartholomew Columbus. So that's Columbus, his son, and his brother. He sent them back to Spain in chains, and Christopher was finally released by the Reyes Catholicos on December 12th. So he was in chains for 5 weeks. He was ordered to the court at Granada, where he is made to hold accountable for the actions and explain. The Reyes Catholicos allowed Columbus to keep his title of Admiral of the Seas, but appointed a new governor, Nicolas de Olivando, and sent the new governor to Santo Domingo with a great fleet. But Columbus asked to be allowed to lead another voyage of exploration, which was granted, end of February 1502. So he sails at the beginning of May, and he has 4 ships with under 150 men, including his son Fernando and his brother Bartholomew. When he arrives in Santo Domingo, the governor Orvando wouldn't let him enter the harbor. He's like, not about that. So Columbus sails across the Caribbean to the coast of Honduras, where he ran into another storm. And this is when he realized, hey, this is not Asia, and this is between me and the Indies. He tries to set up a new...
So how many years did it take him going back and forth to realize, oh, I guess this really isn't Asia? Like, what is that?
So it's probably like 1502. Yeah.
So 10 years.
About 10 years.
Of going back and forth.
Yeah.
Interacting with people who are like, we don't know what you're talking about. And he finally is like, all right, I guess you're right.
Well, I mean, you could tell he kind of knew because he made the people like swear an oath that this is the Indies, but they were like,
still,
I know. So I just love this. He's trying to found a colony in western what is now Panama. It is not suitable. It's one of the rainiest places in the world, and the natives were very hostile.
Rightly so.
So he leaves, and he's trying to sail back to Santo Domingo, and it takes them from April 16th to June 10th to fight their way eastward across the south coast of Cuba. But their ship is getting really in like really bad condition, so they're forced to turn to Jamaica, and they run the ships aground at June 23rd. So Columbus and his 116 remaining crew members were forced to spend the year at St. Anne's Bay in Jamaica. When they reached Santo Domingo in August 1503, the governor would not let him charter a rescue ship. And the problem is, while he was over there, he faced a mutiny with his men because they were trying to leave on their own. They're like, we out. He's like, no, like, we out. No, fine. But they also found out that the governor knew how dangerous his predicament was on St. Anne's Bay, but wouldn't let anyone rescue him. Probably because he was such an asshole. So there was an actual pitched battle between Columbus's followers and the mutineers on May 29th. And finally, they got a chartered vessel at the end of June 1504. Columbus chartered another boat and left for Spain September 1504. By the time he arrives in November, he's ill. The Queen Isabel dies November 26th, and Columbus recovers his health enough and goes to see King Ferdinand. He tries to get the king to allow another expedition. So mind you, no matter how bad his expedition goes, he goes, let's try this again. We should definitely try this again. And he keeps following the court around Spain. He moved into the house of the city of Valladolid in April 1506. He makes his will May 19th, and he dies the following day. And that's
just in the nick of time.
So the answer, the tip-off, was why is he thought to be buried in two different locations? Well, at first, they believed he was buried in in the Dominican Republic, or the island of Hispaniola, and so there was a tomb over there, and then they brought the rumor was that his bones several times, so they moved it from Santo Domingo to back to Spain, back and forth and such. But a couple of years ago, they did DNA testing and they determined that Spain has the correct bone. So Columbus wanted to be buried in the Americas, but there was no church of significant stature at that point. So yeah, So in 1537, Maria de Rojas y Toledo, who is a widow of one of Columbus's sons, Diego, sent the bones of her husband and his father to the cathedral in Santo Domingo for burial. They were there until 1795, when Spain had ceded Hispaniola to France, and they were like, we're not leaving Columbus's bones. So they took the remains they believed were his to Havana and then to Seville when the Spanish-American War broke out. But in 1877, there were workers in the cathedral in Santo Domingo Cathedral who unearthed a lead box with the inscription, "Illustrious Distinguished Male Don Cristobal Colon." And so it's Christopher Columbus. And they were like, oh, these are the correct bones. And so it's been going back and forth. And this article was from 2006. So since 2006, they did DNA testing, determined that Spain has the correct bones. Yeah. So I'm pretty sure they probably were doing, like, they're going to do more testing on the other bone, but they believe that Spain has the correct bones. But there's still tombs to both. So you can see he's buried in Seville. So you can see, go to the Seville Cathedral, and they're like, Christopher. I've seen it. It's pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm. Cool. What an interesting bit of trivia.
So now you know. Use it for Jeopardy. I know. And that's the story of Christopher Columbus.
That was good.
Thank you for listening to The Cult of Domesticity. We are available on iTunes, Google Play, Chorus, Podbean. If we are not yet on your preferred app, let us know so we can fix that stat. And remember to rate, review, and subscribe on iTunes. It's the best way to spread the word of this podcast.
So check us out on Facebook and Twitter at Domestic Podcast to get the episode tip off, recipe of the week, and additional information about the week's topics. If you'd like to suggest a recipe or a topic, you can email us at domesticpodcast@gmail.com.
Long distance high five?
I think we were in a long distance high five, yeah.
You left me hanging for so long.
Sorry.